Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rome, Strategy of Empire, by James Lacey, narrated by Joel Richards. Introduction, Standing on the Shoulders of Giants. Similar to books on the battles of Gettysburg and Waterloo, the market for new works on the Roman Empire seems inexhaustible. In books, movies, plays, and just about any other media, writers and producers labor to meet an unquenchable thirst for retellings of all or part of the story of the glory of Rome. In fact, the night before I wrote this chapter, I fell asleep watching Amazon Prime series Britannia. As I drifted off to sleep, I heard a character repeatedly shouting, "Behold the power of Rome!" Still, demand for new works on the Roman Empire does not justify adding to the thousands of works already in print. That would require the historian to have uncovered new information, or to have interpreted existing finds and evidence in a new way. I believe this work falls into the latter category. The story of ancient Rome has always fascinated me, and over the years I have tried to keep up with the most important works published on the topic. But I am at heart, and by training, a military historian. Furthermore, although I am a scholar, I do not have an established specialty. Most historians, even military historians, are encouraged to specialize in one specific area, such as World War II or 17th century warfare. Many of these historians maintain an interest in other areas, but the overwhelming thrust of the research and writing is in their selected specialty. Historians whose research and writing range from Plato to NATO are increasingly rare. Moreover, I have spent decades in the military world as an infantry officer, with my time spent equally in the active forces and reserves. Upon retirement, I moved into the strategic world, first at the Institute for Defense Analyses, a think tank catering to the United States military's Joint Staff and Office of the Secretary of Defense, and then on to become a professor of strategic studies at the Marine Corps War College. Finally, I was appointed to the Marine Corps University's Horner Chair of War Studies. In each of these roles, I have been involved in examining current and future strategic policy for the United States military. But I remain a historian who has been able to make good use of my studies of the past as a prism for peering into the future, for the past is always prologue. Moreover, if I do have a subspecialty, it is in the economics and financing of great power competition and conflict, factors upon which the foundation of any practicable strategy must be built. I hope that my combination of over 2 decades as a military officer, 15 years as a professional strategic analyst, and a lifetime of studying strategy and warfare will allow me to bring a unique viewpoint to the study of Roman strategy. I have been studying and teaching courses on the economics of strategy for 15 years, and wrote my dissertation on the economic foundations of World War II. While Strategy of Empire is not a book on Roman economics, I am convinced that without some grounding on the economic realities of the empire, it is impossible to comprehend Roman strategic decision-making or the course of Roman history. Moreover, economics, the foundation of all strategy, is an area often neglected by historians and strategists, including Edward Luttwak, who in his Grand Strategy of the Roman Empire failed to address the topic. One wonders, given the importance of economics for formulating and implementing strategy, why is it absent from so many historical works? The best explanation I can offer is that political economy and finance are so removed from the expertise of historians and today's strategists that they ignore the topic. For instance, several years back I attended a conference focused on grand strategy at the Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island. In the first moments of the opening speaker's talk, he said, "If we are here to talk about grand strategy, or even strategy, we must talk about economics. For if we are not discussing economics, we are not talking about strategy." This comment was loudly applauded by the approximately 200 participants. But after the applause had quieted, the topic was never again addressed during the remaining 4 days of the conference. One, however, must tread carefully when discussing economic and financial topics in the ancient world. For, as Everett Wheeler long ago warned me, we know nothing about Roman economics. It is all assumptions and guesses piled atop of other assumptions and guesswork. I do not believe Wheeler was right when he said this to me, and he is certainly wrong now. Over the last few decades, scholars in the field, including Peter Temin, Paul Erdkamp, Walter Scheidel, Ian Morris, Richard Soller, Andrew Wilson, Ilya Locascio, William Harris, Alan Bowman, and many others, have accomplished tremendous work. Building on the pioneering work of M. I. Rostovsev, Tenney Frank, and Richard Duncan Jones, scholars have greatly enlarged our knowledge and understanding of the Roman economy. Consequently, I do not have to be an expert on the foundational, written, epigraphical, or archaeological evidence on which these scholars based their conclusions, as I have the luxury of standing atop their shoulders. Strategy of empire, therefore, does not break any new ground when discussing the economy of ancient Rome. Rather, it integrates the consensus of findings of those just listed into a wider examination of Roman strategic thinking, as well as how the economy impacted strategic decisions and their execution. Economics is not the only area of Roman scholarship where I get to stand on the shoulders of giants. In recent decades, there has been an explosion of masterful works that have employed new research tools, methodologies, and discoveries to remake the field of Roman studies. I became aware of this explosion in the mid-2000s when I was listening to a cafeteria conversation between two well-known historians that was heading in the direction of a heated argument. The topic was the fall of the Western Roman Empire, and one participant heatedly declared the other's interpretation of events wrong. The reply came back, "Have you read Wickham or Heather?" To which the first professor answered, "I have read Gibbon from cover to cover, and that's enough." The exasperated reply came back, "If you have not read Wickham and Heather, then you don't know anything about the topic, and I'm wasting my time." He then stood and stalked off. I excused myself soon after, and went and ordered Peter Heather's and Chris Wickham's books and pored over them. That started 15 years of reading works by great historians, David Potter, Fergus Miller, Benjamin Isaac, Noel Lenski, Michael Kolakowski, A.D. Lee, Hugh Elton, C.R. Whitaker, J.E. Lendon, Kenneth Harrell, A. Cameron, Ward Perkins, Philip Sabin, Hans van Wies, Michael Whitby, and a host of others. So although I also read the works of all the great historians who wrote during the empire, from Livy to Procopius, I did not have to interpret them or try and discover where they erred, exaggerated, or made stuff up. Others, much better versed in the intricacies and pitfalls of dealing with ancient sources, have already done the heavy lifting in that regard. So although the Historia Augusta is a fascinating read, one must be extremely careful in its use, as much of it is clearly fabricated. Separating truth from fiction in the Historia has been the work of scholars who have dedicated their professional lives to the study of ancient Rome. It cannot be done by dedicated amateurs such as myself. My contribution is to take the work of these scholars and add value in areas where I have a degree of expertise that these scholars do not typically possess or do not claim as a specialty. This includes practical knowledge of military planning and execution, strategic studies, and military history as a specialty. Is it fair to ask what makes this approach valuable? My response rests upon the reception that most, but not all, historians of ancient Rome gave to Luttwak's grand strategy of the Roman Empire. He stole a march on many historians when he published his dissertation on Roman grand strategy by taking on a topic that had been generally neglected. Since then, a huge number of scholars have entered the fray. A few, very few, have supported Luttwak's interpretations. While most have condemned his findings and replaced them with their own interpretations of Roman motives and actions. The resulting historical consensus is that the Romans did not act on any preconceived strategic plan. Rather, their approach was always one of ad hoc responses as a succession of crisis events unfolded. In this scholarly paradigm, not only did Rome lack a grand strategy, but its ruling elites were incapable of even thinking in strategic terms. I contend that the Romans were, for their time, very sophisticated strategic thinkers, who possessed all the tools to plan long-term strategies and to act according to those plans. I will lay out my basic argument for this contrary opinion at the start of the book, before delving into the specifics of Roman strategy during various periods of the empire's history. In laying out my initial argument, I take a contradictory position to many of the greatest historians in the field of ancient history. By no means should my comments on strategy be viewed as attacks on their scholarship, nor on their interpretations of the ancient sources. In fact, my narrative relies on their work. Where I take exception to their findings is in one narrow portion of their studies where scholars have made incorrect generalizations and interpretations in an area I have spent my professional life studying and employing in practice. My two fondest hopes for this book are that many of you will find the creation and execution of Roman strategy as fascinating as I have, and that this book may spark a new round of debate, as passionate and as fruitful as that provoked by Luttwak when he first addressed the topic. Part 1. Themes and Topics. Chapter 1. Could the Romans do strategy? Before addressing the question posed in the title of this chapter, we must take a short definitional diversion. Over the past few decades, an astonishing number of historians and modern strategic thinkers have tied themselves in knots arguing over whether the concept of strategy even existed before the end of the 18th century, when the word strategy finally made it into the lexicon. In this rendering, the notion of strategic thinking is a byproduct of the Enlightenment, when learned persons placed great faith in man's ability to understand the world through empirical science and reason. War, the greatest of all human endeavors, was not accepted from this movement. This is really a matter of semantic interest, in much the same way as one can ask whether those who made Greek fire were employing chemistry, which was not generally recognized as a science until Antoine Lavoisier published Elements of Chemistry in 1787. Others were certainly thinking about strategy and acting on their ideas long before Enlightenment thinkers began to systematize our mental approaches to the topic. In any event, strategy is always and everywhere a matter of ends, ways, and means, as seen through the prism of risk. Half of the professional strategic thinkers listening to this will scoff upon finishing that last sentence. The reasons for doing so are numerous, starting with the accusation that the very simplicity of the ends, ways, means paradigm just leaves out too much that is required to develop a firm understanding of the topic. Still, the basis of any good model is simplicity, although we must keep in mind that simplicity seldom implies a lack of depth. Einstein's theory of relativity, for instance, has often been summarized on a postage stamp. In the case of defining strategy, as with E equals MC squared, the complexity increases the more one ponders the practical realities of strategic thinking and execution. If we can torture the analogy to Einstein's theory just a bit further, one might note that despite its continuing relevance in explaining the macro universe, much of the theory's elegance has been overthrown by the weird chaos of the quantum world. Similarly, even the best considered, most well-planned strategy will quickly fall into shambles once confronted by the chaotic challenges of the real world. Thus, the best strategies endure despite chaos because resilience and the capacity for rapid adaptation were built into the strategy from the start. As Helmut von Moltke, the Elder, The general most responsible for winning the wars that united Germany into a single state once said, "Strategy is a matter of expedience that takes it far beyond the realm of mere scholars." Typically, strategy, when applied to the interactions of states, is narrowly defined as the bridge between an established policy and the military aims necessary to achieve it. This is clearly what is meant by the term military strategy. But a state's aims are not always achieved through military force, and a strategy focused entirely upon military affairs, without taking account of the economic, political, social, and diplomatic structures that underpin and support it, is doomed. This broader concept of strategy, commonly referred to as grand strategy, seeks to align all the resources and institutions of the state towards specific policy goals. At its highest level, the primary goal of any state is survival. What else a state can accomplish within a strategic global context rests upon the distribution of power within the system and must always be judged in relative terms. Still, many a large forest has been sacrificed in order to publish works that define strategy, such that there are now thousands of definitions differentiated only by such subtleties that would bewilder Thomas Aquinas and the scholastics who surrounded him. So I'm going to offer two sets of definitions. The first are those proposed by my own institution, the Marine Corps War College. In its simplest form, strategy is a theory on how to achieve a stated goal. Another way to think about strategy is to consider how to get from a current state or condition to a desired state or condition. In Joint Publication 3.0, Joint Operations, the Joint Chiefs of Staff offer their definition of strategy. Strategy, a prudent idea or set of ideas for employing the instruments of national power in a synchronized and integrated fashion to achieve theater, national, and/or multinational objectives. American strategists also employ the DIME paradigm in their strategic thinking. DIME is an acronym for the process of integrating a myriad of diplomatic, informational, military, and economic strategies and concerns into a coherent grand strategy aimed at protecting and enhancing our national values and interests. The interesting thing about strategy is that, like the nature of war, the purposes underlying its methodologies never change. Rome never came up with a fancy acronym for the lists of interests influencing grand strategy, nor did they ever express their strategic thinking in terms of the ends, ways, means mode. But if they were doing any strategic thinking and acting on those thoughts, they were employing precisely these concerns and methods. The crucial question, therefore, is whether the Romans were capable of thinking about the future in strategic terms. This question has riled the field of Roman studies for two generations, and now that we have defined the terms, we can turn to the details of that debate. In Book One of Rhetoric, Aristotle lists the subjects that all politicians and statesmen must be familiar with. They are five in number: ways and means, war and peace, national defense, imports and exports, and legislation. According to Aristotle, policymakers must, as part of mastering ways and means, be familiar with the extent of the state's resources and their sources. Further, they must be thoroughly acquainted with how revenues are being expended by the state, so that they are not wasted on superfluous pursuits. In terms of war and peace, Aristotle urges politicians to apply themselves to comprehending the extent of a state's actual and potential military strength, as well as that of enemy states. The philosopher also makes a strong case for the importance of studying military history to comprehend how states have waged war in the past, as well as specifically studying how potential foes have previously waged war. In modern strategy courses, this would all be consolidated under ways and means, as would his comments on national defense. He ought to know all about the methods of defense in actual use, such as the strength and character of the defensive force and the positions of the forts. This last means that he must be well acquainted with the lie of the country, in order that the strategic points may be guarded with special care. Aristotle's concern with imports and exports would be familiar to any current student enrolled in a strategic studies program, for he emphasizes gaining an appreciation of tracking what and how much is being traded between states, a very modern preoccupation. His prime concern in this regard was ensuring that rulers were taxing cargoes leaving and entering ports or crossing borders, a crucial source of revenue. Modern states see this comparison in increasingly mercantilist terms, but the crucial importance of these flows remains the same. It is when Aristotle discusses legislation that we begin to see hints of Karl von Clausewitz's trinity: the people, the government, and the military. For instance, he addresses the crucial importance of political institutions as a widely accepted legal framework in securing and enhancing the strength of the state. Neither Aristotle nor Rome's ruling elite had a modern understanding of these issues, but they clearly understood their importance. Rome never came close to having perfect institutions. No state in history has ever been so blessed. But when one discusses strategy, what matters is not the perfection of one's institutions, but rather their relative superiority to rivals in terms of outcomes. Rome offered institutions and a legal structure superior to those of any previously found in the ancient world, and for most of the empire's existence, its institutional framework was far superior to that of any of its competitors. Unfortunately, Rome, at least until Diocletian's reforms, never truly developed its administrative infrastructure much beyond that required to manage a city-state. But by working with local elites and absorbing their local economic and tax structures into the empire's greater edifice, Rome's organizational structure proved sufficient to rule a huge geographical area for nearly half a millennium. Aristotle's ideas about what a statesman or policymaker should deeply consider can, with minimal rewording, be used to teach the foundations of strategic thinking in today's military's professional education system. If one took these ideas out of context and put them in front of a professor from any military war college, she would immediately recognize them as the underpinnings of all modern strategic thinking. The Romans had a passion for Greek culture and were devoted readers of Aristotle, as well as the histories of Herodotus and Thucydides, all of which would have been absorbed by every educated Roman. These histories are still taught to senior officers in every war college because, along with Aristotle's writing, they demonstrate a very sophisticated level of strategic thinking. So, to assume that the Romans were incapable of thinking in strategic terms, one has to believe that somewhere between Aristotle putting his strategic thinking framework on paper, or papyrus, and the advent of the Roman Empire, educated elites mysteriously lost their capacity to think about statecraft and empire in strategic terms. But this is precisely what the overwhelming numbers of Roman scholars have proposed and accepted since Luttwak published The Grand Strategy of the Roman Empire. This historical consensus is elegantly presented in The Cambridge Ancient History. It is probably incorrect to define Roman military policy in terms of long-term strategical objectives, which saw the emergence of various systems designed to achieve scientific defensible frontiers. For one thing, the Romans lacked a high command or government office capable of giving coherent direction to overall strategy, which was therefore left to the decision of individual emperors and their advisors. Military decisions were probably ad hoc, as emperors were forced into temporary defensive measures to limit damage and then counterattacked when circumstances and resources allowed. In any case, the Romans lacked the kind of intelligence information necessary to make far-reaching empire-wide decisions. Indeed, they probably did not have a clear-cut view of frontiers, and came slowly to the idea that they should constitute a permanent barrier and form a delineation of Roman territory. Take a moment to ponder the meaning of this statement. If it is true, then we must accept that for 500 years, the empire spent as much as 4/5 of its tax revenue on a 450,000-man army, building and maintaining 3,000 miles of fortified frontiers, limes, supported by tens of thousands of miles of military roads, and conducted hundreds of prolonged military campaigns, all without anyone ever once stopping to give any thought as to how all of this was put together. Security and war were the empire's overriding concerns and the primary business of the state. It is unimaginable that they approached such a monumental effort, sustained over 5 centuries, as a haphazardly constructed afterthought or in an ad hoc fashion. In a crisis, certain decisions may have been ad hoc, as they are today, but they were certainly made within a specific strategic context, which rulers and their counselors grasped and understood. Still, despite the obvious logic of the previous observations, the overwhelming historical consensus is that Rome did not think in strategic terms, nor was it possible for Romans to do so. Several arguments have been marshaled to make this case, and it is best to take each of these in turn. The first revolves around Roman geographical ignorance and faulty comprehension of the geographical space within the empire and beyond. This debate has already been overanalyzed by modern scholars, but as this topic remains central to any denial of Roman capacity for strategic planning, it must be tackled once again, starting with Susan Mattern, who argues, "The Roman view of the geographical world seems at first schematic, that is, simplistic, too simplistic a framework for a complex geopolitical strategy." In this, Mattern is following in the footsteps of Benjamin Isaac, who, citing Fergus Miller, wrote that the Romans did not have a sufficiently clear or accurate notion of topographical realities to allow them to conceive of the overall military situation in global strategic terms. What Rome did have, as Mattern repeatedly states, were itineraries, itineraria, that were used to plan travel from one point to another within the empire. From her perspective, such itineraries were fine for planning a party about to embark on an extended period of travel, but useless for military or strategic planning. Isaac amplifies this by stating that it requires only a glance to determine that such itineraries would be useless to today's military planners. One wonders, then, why the 4th century author Vegetius would recommend their use for that specific purpose. As he warns in De Re Militari, first he should have thoroughly written out as fully as possible itineraries of all the regions in which the war is being waged, so that he can learn thoroughly the intervals between places, not only regarding the number of miles, but even the quality of the roads, and inspect carefully the shortcuts, bypaths, mountains, and rivers, faithfully described. Indeed, the more prudent generals were fortified by having obtained itineraries of the provinces to which necessity used to take them, which were not only annotated, but even drawn. By adding "even drawn," Vegetius is almost certainly describing the creation of maps, of the type many historians believe the Romans did not employ in their military operations. Isaac does comment on Vegetius's advice that troop movements should be planned by employing itineraria picta, but agrees with Mattern that these picture-laden itineraries were of little use in strategic planning. However, before judging whether itineraries were of any use for strategic planning, it helps to understand what a Roman itinerary looks like and what kinds of information it provided. One of the most famous itineraries, which is still extant, is the Antonine Itinerary, a list of place names with notations as to the distance between them. It dates from the 3rd century CE and may have been created for Caracalla's campaigns in the East. Any Roman general with access to this document or anything similar could instantly assess the daily march distances from start to stop, and just as easily calculate the distances along various routes from any point in the empire to any other point. The most famous and best preserved of these itineraries with pictures is the Tabula Poitingeriana, the Poitinger map. This is not just a list of locations and distance, but more like a road map presenting the information in graphic form. Roads are shown by lines, with the distances between towns and cities notated along each line. In addition to this kind of detailed itinerary, the Romans employed other sources of geographical data, but only a few of these have survived the centuries. The most famous that has come down to us are Strabo's Geographica, Ptolemy's Geographia, and World Map, and the map of Agrippa, the Orbis Terrarum. Seen through modern eyes, these maps seem to have major problems, and the Roman worldview is certainly not ours. But how Rome saw the world is not the crucial question. Rather, one must ask whether the Romans' worldview, as well as their geographical tools, itineraries and basic maps, was sufficiently accurate to enable them to plan and execute strategy. Susan Mattern, like most historians, believes it was not. Modern policymakers would not dream of conducting foreign policy relations or planning a war, much less undertaking one, without accurate scaled maps. This statement is not correct. Maps with the detail and accuracy of the kind most historians declare necessary for the planning of strategy and the conduct of military operations did not really exist until the Austro-Hungarian Empire undertook to map much of Western Europe, a task not completed and published until the eve of World War I. Yet no one claims that when Napoleon was crawling over the inferior maps of his era, sometimes bumping heads with his chief cartographer, General Barclay de Alba, that he was not engaged in strategic campaign planning. If adequate maps are the basic foundational necessity for strategic planning, then no state or army was capable of plotting strategy before the modern era. But we find Vegetius advising a Roman general, if any difficulty arises about the choice of roads, he should procure proper and skillful guides. He should put them under a guard and spare neither promises nor threats to induce them to be faithful. They will acquit themselves well when they know it is impossible to escape, and are certain of being rewarded for their fidelity or punished for their perfidy. Similarly, Frederick the Great during the Seven Years' War, 1756 to 1763, advised his generals that, when seeking intelligence about an area, they should find a rich citizen with a large family and reward him for information, while at the same time promising to hack his family to death before his eyes if he is less than truthful. Clearly, Frederick, commanding approximately 1,500 years after Vegetius wrote his instructions, was still having problems getting accurate maps on which to plan campaigns and battles. Still, no one believes that Frederick or the other generals and statesmen of the era were incapable of strategic planning. The fact is that Roman itineraries provide exactly the type of information required for strategic planning, particularly in its military dimensions. President Bill Clinton once said, during a visit to the aircraft carrier USS Theodore Roosevelt, "When word of crisis breaks out in Washington, it's no accident the first question that comes to everyone's lips is, 'Where is the nearest carrier?'" Neither Clinton nor the Joint Chiefs had any concern about global geography beyond the distance of the carriers to the crisis area and how long it would take them to make the transit. Henry Kissinger once called aircraft carriers 100,000 tons of diplomacy. Similarly, Rome's legions were the mobile diplomacy of the empire. In any crisis, there were only three things an emperor needed to know: where the crisis was, how far from the crisis the nearest available legions were, and how long it would take the legions to travel between these two points. Simply put, no emperor had to know a single geographical fact that was not included in the itineraries of the time. In them, an emperor and his advisors would find detailed information about distances for each leg of the legion's marching route. From that point, it was all about assigning commanders, issuing orders for the legions to march, and prepositioning supplies, food, and fodder along the route of the march. This last task was easily accomplished by sending messengers to each stopping point on the itinerary, or by the legions sending officers ahead. Interestingly, while doing some research on the Battle of Yorktown, I came across a map employed by Generals Washington and Rochambeau to move their combined forces from Rhode Island and New York to Yorktown. Like the itinerary-based maps the Romans must have used, the only markings on Washington's maps were the routes of the march and the planned stopping points each evening. All the geographical space along those routes was a matter of supreme indifference to the Allied commanders and their staffs. And, as the Romans must have done, Washington and Rochambeau sent messengers ahead of the armies whose job was to order food that would be collected along each point listed on the map. In short, the tools available to the Romans were those still being employed nearly 2 millennia later by generals and statesmen who found them sufficient for their strategic needs. The reality of Roman strategic thinking was that they employed a point-to-point analysis to strategy and crisis resolution. Their primary concern was distances and time. When the need arose to move from point A to point B, the fact that the Alps might be in the way was of little concern. What mattered was the number of days it took to cross the space, whether it was occupied by rolling grasslands, deserts, or mountains. Interestingly, in the wargaming world, many designers have discovered that the easiest way to think about and simulate the strategic level of any conflict is through using point-to-point designs, itineraries, that look a lot like the Peutinger map. One of the best war games simulating Roman strategic issues, Pax Romana, also employs a point-to-point methodology to address how Rome reacted to problems. What served the Romans well still underpins how today's generals and statesmen plan and execute military-based strategic endeavors. When planning for crises in any part of the world, almost all military planners start with an analysis of the hubs and nodes that make up the various transport networks. Thus, when planners are told to move military forces halfway across the world, they do not think about maps as most of us would. Rather, they think in terms of networks filled with pathways and nodes where the major variable is the mode of travel, air, land, or sea, and includes basic information, such as how long it takes to go between nodes and the carrying capacity of the vehicles involved. Until the troops are in close contact and fighting, the underlying geographical aspects involved in military operations are barely a consideration. In fact, systems and network-centric warfare, which is based on protecting one's crucial nodes while wrecking those of an enemy, has now become the basis of almost all military planning. Anyone receiving a briefing on current military plans would be struck by the fact that there is no requirement for a geographic map. To strategic planners, all of the geographic features and pretty colors on common maps are nothing but eye candy. Handed a list of nodes, transit speeds for various modes of travel, and the capacity of each node and pathway to handle traffic, military strategists can deploy the full might of the U.S. military anywhere in the world without ever referencing a geographic map. One can easily see how such information, once set down on paper, begins to look suspiciously like the itineraries the Romans worked with. In short, if a Roman emperor wants to think about future strategy or react to a major crisis in a distant part of the empire, itineraries are the perfect instrument for doing so. Moreover, the Romans, although they never spelled out their approach in manuals, clearly understood the crucial importance of nodes, towns, cities, fortresses, and so on, and paths, the Roman road network, rivers, and the Mediterranean. The evidence, far from indicating that the Romans did not have the geographic tools to think in strategic terms, demonstrates the exact opposite. Rome possessed the precise basic tools that would enable a level of sophisticated strategic thinking comparable to that of the modern era. Rome's supposed lack of interest in maps or geographical intelligence has been extended by historians to suggest that they had a dearth of information regarding the empire's separate theaters of conflict. This would mean that for nearly 1,000 years, Roman military commanders conducted military campaigns without any knowledge of the local terrain, possible marching routes, or where their enemies might be. That Rome chose simply to plunge into the unknown and hope for the best. This is absurd. Voluminous evidence in the historical record demonstrates that Roman commanders took a tremendous interest in local geography and were fully capable of planning huge campaigns over vast distances. For instance, in 6 CE, Augustus gave his approval for the destruction of the Germanic Marcomanni Confederation under its king, Maroboduus. This was no mean undertaking, as many of the tribe's warriors had at times found employment as Roman auxiliaries, and were therefore expertly familiar with Roman methods of war. As Velleius Paterculus, one of Tiberius's staff officers, states, "The body of guards protecting the kingdom of Maroboduus, which by constant drill had been brought almost to the Roman standard of discipline, soon placed him in a position of power that was dreaded even by our empire." To remove this looming threat, Augustus had his general, Tiberius, the future emperor, mobilize 12 legions and planned a pincer movement from 2 widely separated provinces. Even conceiving of such a plan, never mind executing the logistics of such a vast enterprise, requires huge amounts of staff work, underpinned by a healthy understanding of the enemy forces, as well as the distances and geography involved. Velleius Paterculus certainly showed a deep knowledge of the threat posed by Maroboduus's huge, highly trained army, as well as of the threat created by the geography of the region. His army, which he had brought up to the number of 70,000 foot and 4,000 horse, he was also to be feared on this account that, having Germany at the left and in front of his settlements, Pannonia on the right, and Noricum in the rear of them, he was dreaded by all as one who might at any moment descend upon all. Nor did he permit Italy to be free from concern as regards his growing power, since the summits of the Alps which mark her boundary were not more than 200 miles distant from his boundary line. Such was the man and such the region that Tiberius Caesar resolved to attack from opposite directions in the course of the coming year. Cynthius Saturninus had instructions to lead his legions through the country of the Cati into Boiohemum, for that is the name of the region occupied by Maroboduus. Cutting a passage through the Hercynian forest which bounded the region, while from Carnuntum, the nearest point of Noricum in this direction, he, Tiberius, himself undertook to lead against the Marcomanni army, which was serving in Illyricum. This great attack was called off when the legions had to be diverted to put down the Pannonian Revolt, 6 to 9 CE. As a consequence of the Varian disaster, when 3 legions were annihilated deep in the German forests in 9 CE, another attack into Marcomanni territory was not contemplated again for over 150 years, during the reign of Marcus Aurelius. Before moving on, it is worth noting another expedition deep into Germany, also led by Tiberius. As recounted by Paterculus, a Roman army with its standards was led 400 miles beyond the Rhine as far as the river Elbe, which flows past the territories of the Seminones and the Ermunduri. And with this wonderful combination of careful planning and good fortune on the part of the general, and a close watch upon the seasons, the fleet which had skirted the windings of the seacoast sailed up the Elbe, effected a junction with Caesar and the army, bringing with it a great abundance of supplies of all kinds. Consider both examples. The first called for one pincer, starting from modern Mainz, to meet the other arm of the pincer, which started from the great Roman fortress of Carnuntum, well to the east of Vienna. The vast distances involved cover almost the same geographical area as Napoleon's Ulm-Austerlitz campaign and Wagram campaign, some 1,800 years later. The second example is even more remarkable, as it called for coordinating the actions of two forces out of contact with one another, an army fighting its way across hostile territory, and a naval force navigating in waters where no Roman fleet had ever sailed. Nearly 1,600 years later, in 1588, despite 2 years of planning, the Spanish Armada, in a similar enterprise in approximately the same region, failed to link up with the Spanish Army of Flanders to invade England. It was not until General William T. Sherman's army arrived at Savannah, Georgia in 1864, and found a resupply fleet waiting for them, that an enterprise of similar scope and hazards was again accomplished by design. The point is that neither expedition could be planned, never mind executed, without a huge amount of geographical information and comprehension. Further examples of Roman geographic knowledge and its employment in the conduct of military campaigns litter the ancient literature. This makes one thing certain. The Romans had a thorough grasp of the geography within the bounds of their empire, as well as huge swaths of territory immediately beyond their borders. Moreover, as the two previous examples demonstrate, the Romans had a clear idea of the capacity and capabilities of the threats within these regions. That does not mean that surprises, such as the Varian disaster, were impossible. In truth, Rome was often caught unawares, and Roman armies suffered many embarrassments. But for the most part, these were the result of misreading an enemy's intent, not a lack of knowledge of their capabilities. Rome's supposed lack of geographic knowledge has fed one of the more enduring myths of Roman studies, that they had no idea of a fixed frontier on the other side of which security threats lay. Frontiers instead being simply zones or districts within which Rome managed economic and diplomatic affairs with its neighbors. Two of the greatest authorities on the Roman frontiers have declared that the frontiers, limes, were administrative concept unconnected with the military structures that might be found within them. The historian David Cherry, in The Cambridge Ancient History, neatly sums up where this burgeoning consensus has led. None of the frontiers appear to have been wholly defensive in purpose, partly also because the Romans themselves do not seem to have considered the frontiers to be either lines of defense or demarcation. It is now widely agreed instead that the frontiers functioned as zones or borderlands. As far as Cherry is concerned, the Romans themselves never understood that the frontiers behaved militarily or administratively. In this view, there is little reason to believe that the Roman authorities considered it to be their duty to protect the provincial populations against those who lived beyond the frontiers. Finally, Cherry maintains that even if the imperial government desired to develop a coherent defensive system of defensive barriers and fortifications, it is unlikely that it could have overcome the delays of communications and transportation that were a necessary consequence of the vast distances which separated the frontiers from the capital and from each other. But that is exactly what the Romans did. They overcame vast distances and built an integrated system of defensive structures over thousands of miles of frontiers. Cherry may represent the consensus of historians, but this view flies in the face of the evidence and common sense. As to the questions of whether the Romans considered the frontiers a defensive barrier, it is probably best to let the Romans speak for themselves. As Aristides wrote, "Beyond the outermost ring of the civilized world, you drew a second line, quite as one does in walling a town, an encamped army like a rampart encloses the civilized world in a ring, defended by a barrier of men who have never acquired the habit of flight. Such are the parallel harmonies or systems of defense which curve around you, that circle of the fortifications at individual points, and that ring of those who keep watch over the whole world. All this one can call a ring and circuit of the walls. He is joined by Appian, who wrote, "They surround the empire with great armies, and they garrison the whole stretch of land and sea like a single stronghold." Herodian, writing in the 3rd century CE, added, "When Augustus established his sole rule, he relieved Italians of their duties and stripped them of their arms. In their place, he established a defensive system of forts of the empire, as if to act as a barricade for the Roman Empire. He also fortified the empire by hedging it round with major obstacles, rivers and trenches and mountains, and deserted areas, which were difficult to traverse." While Herodian's comments are more closely related to the situation in the 2nd century CE than they are to the reign of Augustus, he and the others quoted clearly envision a Roman Empire protected by a strong defensive system manned by Rome's legions. A later author, Zosimus, even condemned the Emperor Constantine for weakening this defensive system to man his mobile field armies, the comitatenses, blaming the emperor for adopting measures that gave the barbarians free access to Roman dominions. As Zosimus saw it, Diocletian, by rebuilding the frontier defenses, had secured the empire from barbarian invasion. Constantine, however, by removing soldiers from the frontiers, had destroyed that security. Thus, he stripped the frontiers of protection, and by moving the soldiers to interior cities, made the soldiers effeminate by accustoming them to public spectacles and pleasures. Zosimus, a pagan who tended to blame everything that went wrong with the Roman Empire on its first Christian emperor, is likely not the most reliable writer to interpret the reasons and causes of events. But the point here is that his comments, like the others, demonstrate that the Romans undoubtedly believed they possessed a clearly demarcated, heavily fortified, and well-garrisoned frontier that would defend the empire from enemies beyond it. Historians looking to deny what the Romans so clearly stated have been forced to make diversionary arguments and increasingly strange assertions. For instance, as the term limes appears to have changed definition several times over the empire's 500 years of existence, Isaac uses these changing definitions to claim that we cannot accept that the military installations found along the limes, when they are defined as a line, and throughout the limes, when they are defined as a region, necessarily had a military function. Here he is joined by Whitaker, who believes, as a result of having discovered evidence that the Roman fortress of Kasr Bashir in Jordan was employed for civilian administrative purposes, that we have been too quick to describe frontier buildings as defensive installations, even though a photograph of Kasr Bashir still clearly shows battle towers and crenellated walls. One wonders why these historians never asked why a purely administrative center would need such stout and costly defenses. Surely the location would be just as efficient as an administrative or trading center without them. The expense of such extensive walls can be justified only if they were meant for security. Following Whitaker, many historians believe that the Roman frontiers should be thought of more as a zone than a line. In this, Whitaker is almost certainly correct. Where he goes wrong is his claim that the structures within these zones serve to conduct mostly, if not entirely, administrative and economic functions, as if such purposes could not coexist with a military role. After all, most medieval castles and fortresses performed administrative and economic functions, but no one doubts their concurrent role as military installations. So what are these historians missing? For one, how the definition of limes changed over the centuries is not important. This is a semantic battle that does little to mask actual events on the ground, where it is impossible not to notice that the Romans invested huge sums in constructing a network of walls, fortresses, forts, naval bases, and towers along the entire length of the Rhine and Danube. Because some of these defensive works were not optimally sited, Isaac would have us believe that we cannot divine the true nature of the whole. But we most certainly can do this through the application of a bit of common sense. Walls are built for only two reasons: to keep someone in or to keep someone out. In Rome's case, these extensive lines of fortifications and supporting infrastructure aimed to stop or delay an invasion force before it could seriously threaten the empire. True, throughout the Roman defensive systems, one will, here and there, find a fort that does not appear to have been ideally situated for defensive purposes. All that means is that additional factors must have influenced the location of certain forts and bases. Consider the world today. The United States is littered with well-maintained bases that serve no immediate security need, but are located in a powerful politician's district. Rome was not immune to such pressures. Isaac holds that the Great Danube and Rhine rivers were not barriers, and that the Romans never thought of them as such. He claims that they were easily crossed by boats and rafts, and thus cannot be considered much of an obstacle. He cites Batavian tribesmen trained to swim the Danube with their weapons as an example of why rivers are not truly natural obstacles in a military sense. However, an invading force will need to cross with thousands of troops, pack animals, and wagons. Pace, Isaac. Throughout history, rivers have presented a natural obstacle, one that works against military movements. That a few exceptional swimmers were trained to cross them scarcely lessens the difficulties that would confront an entire army trying to cross rivers, such as the Rhine and the Danube, that were over a mile wide along most of their course. One should also keep in mind that Roman soldiers were well aware of a crucial point of military doctrine that is still repeatedly drilled into every young military officer. Obstacles not covered by troops or firepower are not obstacles. As such, neither the Danube nor the Rhine was ever meant to stand alone against an onrushing horde. That is why Rome reinforced these natural barriers with the most extensive network of fortifications in the ancient world. A network of such grand scope and huge cost that its like was not seen again until the age of Vauban, during the reign of Louis XIV, which, interestingly, saw huge fortifications emplaced in many of the same areas Rome chose to fortify. Within and behind them typically stood 15 or more of Rome's legions. It was the combination of natural barriers, reinforced with a massive defensive infrastructure manned by the stout legions of Rome, that created a military-centered frontier zone. Too many historians have broken these elements down to their constituent parts and analyzed them separately, leading them to claim, erroneously, that Rome did not have coherent strategic plans. But none of these parts was ever intended to stand or operate alone. Rather, they were designed from the start to be integrated, creating a synergistic effect that maintained the frontiers almost inviolate for the first 200 years of the empire's existence. It is one thing to have a band of barbarians crossing the Rhine by swimming or in hastily made boats. It is quite another to do so when there was a legion waiting to hack them to death as they came ashore. Historians appear to understand these facts when they consider movement going in the other direction. In these cases, Roman advances beyond the established frontier zones are always fraught with such difficulties and perils as to make the idea of further conquests too costly to consider. One historian, trying to build this case, quotes an anonymous 4th or 5th century source, De Rebus Bellicis, on military affairs. First of all, it must be recognized that frenzied native tribes, yelping everywhere around, hemmed the Roman Empire in, and that treacherous barbarians, protected by natural defenses, menace every stretch of our frontiers. For these peoples to whom I refer are for the most part either hidden by forests or lifted beyond our reach by mountains or kept from us by the snows. Some, nomadic, are protected by deserts and the blazing sun. There are those who, defended by marshes and rivers, cannot even be located easily, and yet they tear peace and quiet to shreds by their unforeseen attacks. Isaac considers this passage to be of great significance because it was written by a man of military experience and demonstrates that natural defenses, far from being a defensive barrier, acted as an obstacle that prevented the Romans from acting against their enemies. Why he and others supposed that such natural obstacles hinder the movements and actions only of the Romans and not of native tribes is difficult to understand. Major rivers also served other crucial purposes, which made them the natural foundation of any defensive network. For one, they greatly eased logistical and transport problems. The Rhine and Danube were huge highways that alleviated much of the burden of supplying the legions camped alongside them, while also providing high-speed avenues of approach when Rome needed to move troops from one sector of the empire to another. Roman legions would have been drawn toward the great European rivers, if for no other reason than ease of transport. Before moving on, it is crucial that two other misapplications of strategic understanding be put to rest. First is the argument that Romans could not have considered the frontiers we have identified as true or permanent frontiers because they so often sent large military forces beyond them. This imputes to the Romans a siege mentality akin to that of France in 1940, hiding behind its Maginot Line and hoping the Germans would stay on the other side. But this was not the Roman way. For at least the first few centuries of empire, a single imperative appears coded into Rome's strategic DNA: seek out and obliterate troubling populations before they became a threat. The Romans never considered their fortress frontier zones as a final bulwark against the barbarians. Instead, the zones doubled as secure bases from which to gather forces and resources to go deep into enemy territory and strike Rome's foes before they could assemble and organize in such numbers as to make a breakthrough into the heart of the empire a real possibility. Of course, as the threats on the other side of the frontiers changed and Rome's capacity became increasingly feeble, Roman incursions became less frequent. Nonetheless, for most of the empire's existence, the frontiers were both defensive barriers and staging areas for offensives. Whitaker once called upon historians to give up on the myth that the Roman frontiers were an iron curtain through which nothing passed. In this regard, he was correct, but he was thinking in terms of trade, not about how often Rome sent its armies beyond the frontier zones. The idea has also been put forward and generally accepted that Rome could not possibly have had an all-encompassing theory, or as Susan Mattern calls it, a coherent empire-wide plan, because they employed dissimilar approaches in different frontier zones. This fragmentation of approaches based on different situations is held up as proof that Rome was incapable of thinking about grand strategy, and hence simply defaulted to several local expedients. As modern strategists see it, however, historians have gotten it exactly backward. It would have been the height of strategic folly to employ the same approach throughout the empire when local circumstances dictated different solutions. So, rather than displaying a paucity of strategic thinking, the capacity to employ different strategic methodologies based on circumstances, ends, ways, and means, demonstrates a highly sophisticated strategic appreciation. One further reason often presented for why the Romans lacked the capacity to think strategically and to create and execute long-term plans is the lack of a general staff or its ancient equivalent. In the modern era, such a staff is responsible for strategic plans and the coordination of major operations. historians are willing to concede that Roman emperors and even governors employed a consilium to advise them on crucial matters of state and justice. According to Dio, the consilium's membership could vary, but usually consisted of the consuls, trusted advisors, and 15 senators, the latter rotated out every 6 months. And while the power of the consilium varied from emperor to emperor, it gradually gained in power and influence as it took on the duties of administering the empire. So what likely started as an informal body of amici, friends, became increasingly formalized until by the reign of Constantine, it was a separate department of the imperial government, the Sacrum Consistorium. Of course, the Consilium was by no means a general staff or its ancient equivalent, but its existence demonstrates that there was a body of learned men to advise and assist the emperor. Also, it must be noted that until the Prussians created a planning staff in the 19th century, no ruler in history ever had such an entity. Does that mean that Alexander, Gustavus Adolphus, and Napoleon were incapable of strategic thinking? As Everett Wheeler asks, should we accept the view that the institution consuming, even on a conservative estimate, 40 to 50% of the state's revenues, and the most bureaucratized and best documented aspect of Roman government, lacked administrative oversight and planning? In fact, the Romans maintained a huge military administrative apparatus throughout both the Republic and the Empire. How could it have been otherwise? Without such an administrative and planning function, it would be impossible to arm, pay, and feed a far-flung army. Moreover, without some degree of strategic forethought, Rome could not fight wars on multiple fronts, as it did many times in its history. As Wheeler points out, Roman capability in maintaining its army, as well as an emperor's ability to transfer units from one frontier to another, and to assemble expeditionary forces for major wars, clearly indicates that general staff work was done, even if the specific mechanisms of higher command and control remain one of the arcana of Roman government. There is clear evidence that the Romans kept excellent military records throughout the centuries of empire. Tacitus mentions one such document that was read to the Roman Senate soon after Augustus's death in 14 CE. This contained a description of the resources of the state, of the number of citizens and allies under arms, of the fleets, subject kingdoms, provinces, taxes, direct and indirect, necessary expenses, and customary bounties. All these details Augustus had written with his own hand, and had added a counsel that the empire should be confined to its present limits, either from fear or out of jealousy. That such records existed is clear from a later section of Tacitus, which we will hear shortly. Considering that nearly 100 years had passed before Tacitus wrote his account of the period, he must have had extensive records to consult as he outlined the dispositions of the empire's military forces for the year 23 CE. It is also notable that Tacitus not only knew where the legions and fleets were, but also was keenly aware of their purpose. It certainly appears that someone in 23 CE was thinking in strategic terms and laid out such notions so clearly that Tacitus could reiterate them almost a century later. Italy on both seas was guarded by fleets, at Misenum and at Ravenna, and the contiguous coast of Gaul by ships of war captured in the victory of Actium, and sent by Augustus, powerfully manned, to the town of Forojulium. But chief strength was on the Rhine, as a defense alike against Germans and Gauls, and numbered 8 legions. Spain, lately subjugated, was held by 3. Mauritania was King Juba's, who had received it as a gift from the Roman people. The rest of Africa was garrisoned by 2 legions, and Egypt by the same number. Next, beginning with Syria, all within the entire tract of country stretching as far as the Euphrates, was kept in restraint by 4 legions, and on this frontier were Iberian, Albanian, and other kings, to whom our greatness was a protection against any foreign power. Thrace was held by Roe Metalkis and the children of Cotys, the bank of the Danube by two legions in Pannonia, two in Mysia, and two also were stationed in Dalmatia, which, from the situation of the country, were in the rear of the other four, and should Italy suddenly require aid, not too distant to be summoned. But the capital was garrisoned by its own special soldiery. Three city, nine praetorian cohorts, levied for the most part in Etruria and Umbria, or ancient Latium and the old Roman colonies. There were besides, in commanding positions in the provinces, allied fleets, cavalry, and light infantry, of but little inferior strength. But any detailed account of them would be misleading, since they moved from place to place as circumstances required, and had their numbers increased and sometimes diminished. This passage also lays low another one of Isaac's key claims, that if the Romans had any conception of modern strategic principles, they kept quiet about it. Tacitus presents clear evidence that Roman were specifically thinking in terms of mobile defense at the strategic level. As he states, the eight legions on the Rhine were given two crucial missions, to defend against the Germans and to handle any trouble that might arise in recently pacified Gaul, while the Dalmatian legions are tasked with supporting the four legions on the Danube and, if required, marching to the aid of Italy. As James Thorne has pointed out, this is a strategy of mobile defense, if anything is. David Potter believes that the Romans had lost little of the knowledge imparted by Aristotle centuries before. As Cicero claimed, for a senator to know the state, he had to know the state of the army, the treasury, and the allies, friends, and tributaries of Rome, along with the attachment of each to Rome. It would be difficult to find a more succinct understanding of the underpinning of all strategic thinking. Financial strength that paid for the military forces that were the foundation of Roman power. Cicero also warned, in an observation as true 2,000 years later as it was then, that even a state possessed of overwhelming financial and military power could see its advantages thrown away by political imbecility. Almost 400 years after Cicero's death, the Notitia Dignitatum was compiled. This remarkable work, one of the few documents from the Roman chanceries to survive into the modern era, contains a complete accounting of the Western Roman Empire in the 420s and the Eastern Roman Empire in the 400s. It lists all court officials, vicars, and provincial governors, arranged by a praetorian prefecture and diocese. Moreover, it lists by name all military commanders, magistri militum, comites rei militaris, and duces, along with their stations and the regiments under their control. In short, it is a complete record of the military formations of the empire, along with their locations. Between Cicero's death and the completion of the Notitia Dignitatum, we have numerous references to censuses and other strategic assessments that would only be made if they were meant to be consulted for strategic purposes. As Wheeler has noted, if emperors kept detailed records on military strengths and location of troops, did they then fail to ponder their use? Finally, let us turn back to David Cherry's overview of Roman strategy, or the lack thereof, to a comment that demands some further analysis. There is also little reason to believe that the Roman authorities considered it to be their duty to protect the provincial populations against those who lived beyond the frontiers. This viewpoint encapsulates a view that fails to account for either the evidence or common sense. Although no surviving document unequivocally states that the highest purpose of Roman government is to protect the people, one can understand the priorities of Romans through their actions. If they did not care about protecting the civil populations, or if one is ungenerous, protecting the tax revenues that a secure population provided the empire, there would be absolutely no reason to post 30 legions and a similar number of auxiliaries along the Roman frontiers. Rome undertook this tremendous military effort for the express purpose of securing the provinces and populations of the empire. One must ignore 500 years of Roman military exertion to believe otherwise. Coupling the idea that Rome did not truly care about the empire's peoples with the notion that Rome had no conception of the empire's geography negates both the need for a large military establishment, as well as any hopes of deploying one in a useful manner. Following this logic means that Rome, for 500 years, paid for a huge military force without ever being able to articulate a practical justification for its maintenance. Moreover, Rome somehow, by some act of supreme serendipity, managed to post this force along the frontiers, where they were most needed. If the Romans possessed no understanding of geography or capacity for strategic planning, could one assume that they were just as likely to have their legions sunning themselves along the Mediterranean coast as to find them posted along desolate frontier zones? But if we accept that Rome's placement of its legions in the absolute best positions to counter the known threats was not purely the result of a magnificent accident, then we must also accept that the Romans were capable of thinking in strategic terms, as well as of planning and executing strategic concepts. Another idea that has gained currency recently is the notion that the barbarians on the other side of the Roman frontiers were not as dangerous as the ancients made them out to be. If this is true, then for 50 decades, Rome wasted vast sums of money securing itself from enemies that rarely raised themselves above the nuisance level. But is it true? That is what we will discover next. Chapter 2. How dangerous were the barbarians? Morning dew lay heavy on the grass when the first of the invading archers drew back on his bow. For several long seconds, the unknown archer strained while maintaining careful aim. Only when he heard the roaring battle cry of the massed warriors around him did he relax his fingers and release his deadly missile. As the shaft flew, dozens of mounted warriors charged an enemy they had hoped to surprise, but instead found drawn up into a shield wall. In the tumult, our unnamed archer could be forgiven for failing to note that his flint-tipped arrow had struck home, sinking deep into the upper arm of an opponent 50 yards distant. What he surely did not miss were the horses tumbling into the river as man and beast were brought down by opposing archers. As he drew back another arrow, he could also clearly see the gold, tin, and copper bands the rich enemy warriors had adorned themselves with for battle, and began to consider how he could position himself to be among the first to start looting the bodies. As both sides' arrows flew, the opposing battle lines rushed upon one another, coming together in a crashing impact. The end of the battle was not far off now, for there is a limit to how long men can stand toe to toe trying to kill each other. Few could long stand the physical and mental fatigue of close combat, so battles of the period almost always ended in just a few minutes, as one side or the other was overcome by fear and exhaustion. But in those few brutal minutes, hundreds of men died, probably a quarter or more of those involved. In the end, the invaders were repulsed. As the defeated war bands fled past him, our archer hazarded a final look at the battlefield. Then, forgetting his dreams of glory and riches, he raced off. As he ran, he could hear the defenders cheering and shouting their victory chant, "Out! Out! Out!" Although exhausted, the victors' bloodlust was up, and they were soon rushing after their routed foes, striking many of them down from behind. The slaughter abated only when increasing numbers of the victorious warriors stopped to loot the dead. For one fleeting moment, our archer considered his chances of retrieving some gold off the dead cavalrymen. But, not liking the odds, he soon took flight again, joining his brethren on the long trek home. This reflects one plausible reconstruction of a clash of armies 12 centuries before the birth of Christ at a wooden bridge crossing the Tolenza River, 100 miles north of Berlin near the Baltic Sea. As many as 5,000 warriors fought that day, and more than 1,000 of them were killed. What they were fighting over has been lost to the mists of time, but some assumptions are easily made. First, the sheer size of the forces makes it nearly impossible to believe that this was a fight between locals, or even the massed war bands of the entire region. The archaeological evidence bears this out. Strontium, oxygen, and carbon isotopes in the teeth conclusively demonstrate that most of the warriors who died that day came from hundreds of miles off. Furthermore, nitrogen isotopes in the bones indicate a diet heavy in millet, which was a rare foodstuff in northern Europe. Well-preserved bones and artifacts recovered from the area of the battle draw a picture of a relatively sophisticated society, capable of maintaining a large warrior class and able to draw military support from a wide swath of Europe. According to the University College Dublin UCD archaeologist Barry Malloy, this is that smoking gun, forcing historians to tear up most of what they thought they knew about the wealth and sophistication of Northern Europe proto-civilizations. Archaeologists note that the Battle of Tolenz Valley was fought beside a bridge that for 500 years had formed a crucial connection along a major trade artery linking the Baltic amber deposits with the Oder River and then onward to the Bronze Age civilizations around the eastern Mediterranean and Mesopotamia. Amber, used for decoration and jewelry, was prized throughout the ancient world and remains in demand even today. But the Tolenza region was also a major source of tin, the base element for making bronze, and only found in a few locations in the ancient world. Hence, sitting at the crux of the amber and tin trades, the bridge across the Tolenza was arguably the single most economically crucial spot in Germany throughout the Bronze Age. That the German tribesmen were able to recognize the location's vital importance demonstrates a degree of strategic awareness and a capacity for strategic planning, organization, and execution over a large space and through time that most historians believe even advanced ancient societies were incapable of achieving, never mind barbaric Germanic tribesmen. Moreover, it provides archaeological evidence for the near-mythical stories of the Sea Peoples, who came out of the north and, in just 5 decades of ferocious attacks, collapsed nearly every Bronze Age civilization. These stories of crushing assaults, which likely include that of Homer's Troy, are found throughout Bronze Age sites of the Near East. But for the past few decades, historians have tended to discount the contemporary evidence in favor of a system collapse approach. A few examples of the dread occasioned by these military adventurers will suffice to demonstrate that a military explanation for the collapse is possible, even likely. The unruly Sherden, the ancient Egyptian name for the Sea Peoples, whom no one had ever known how to combat, they came boldly sailing in their warships from the midst of the sea, none being able to withstand them. From Astila, during the reign of Ramses II. Cuneiform texts found at the Hittite capital of Hattusash in Ugarit, the Syrian coast, reply to a missive explaining how to combat the Sea Peoples. The enemy ships are already here. They have set fire to my towns and have done great damage in the country. Did you not know that all of my troops were stationed in the Hittite country, and that all my ships are stationed in Lycia and have not yet returned? So that the country is abandoned to itself. There are 7 enemy ships that have come and done very great damage. In another written in Ugaritic cuneiform we find, when your messenger arrived, the army was humiliated and the city was sacked. Our food in the threshing floors was burnt and the vineyards were also destroyed. Our city is sacked. May you know it. May you know it. Despite this and other contemporary evidence, many historians still find it difficult to reconcile their vision of small and loosely connected tribal groupings of Central and Northern Europe having the capacity to launch a sustained invasion capable of collapsing the warlike states of Anatolia and Mesopotamia and come close to toppling mighty Egypt. They find it more likely that the Bronze Age collapse was a result of earthquakes, famines, and climate change that struck in a cascading series of events, recovery from which was beyond the capacity of ancient civilizations. In this interpretation, the Sea Peoples were small bands of wandering marauders who took advantage of the calamities and ensuing chaos of their neighbors, but were not responsible for their collapse. This, however, belies the contemporary evidence, which talks about invaders defeating standing armies, destroying ripening fields, and pillaging walled towns. There is, in fact, no extant record of an ancient society being unable to meet the military challenge because it was already beset by other crises. While other factors were stressing late Bronze Age societies, it is going too far when one removes military invasions as a central cause of the collapse. Those societies under attack certainly knew the cause of their undoing. No land could resist their arms. From Hatti, Kodi, Carchemish, Arzawa, and Alashia on, being cut off at one time, they desolated its people, and its land was like that which had never existed. They were coming forward toward Egypt, while the flame was prepared for them. Their confederation was the Pelset, Jeker, Shekelesh, Danan, and Weshesh, lands united. They laid their hands upon the lands as far as the circuit of the earth. Ramses II Victory Monument. Disregarding such evidence of the destruction wrought by invading armies is a historical conceit, possible only if historians insist that societies outside of the great civilizations of the age were incapable of organizing and executing sustained military operations. The Tolensa battlefield turns this reasoning on its head. It presents indisputable evidence that northern tribes were capable of previously unsuspected feats of military organization, planning, and execution. It is no small accomplishment to organize, move, and, most crucially, feed thousands of warriors over an extended march, and it is nearly impossible to do so on an ad hoc basis. The only way such a force could live off the land on such a march is if there were vast tracts of settled agriculture along the route. If such an agricultural bounty existed, then we must also examine much of our current understanding about the levels of organization of northern tribal societies during the era. The key point here is that more than 1,000 years before Augustus brought the Roman Empire into being, the tribes the Greeks and Romans called barbarians were demonstrating a capacity to sustain land and naval attacks over the course of decades. Moreover, these attacks were pressed with a ferocity and intensity capable of extinguishing all but one, Egypt, of the most powerful empires of the Bronze Age. Whatever the cause of these southward invasions of the northern tribes, they presented a huge and immediate threat to the settled civilizations of Mesopotamia and the Mediterranean. After hundreds of years, the great Mesopotamian and Anatolian empires had reestablished themselves, only to find that the greatest threats to their existence were not one another, but, as Herodotus points out, the horse-mounted Sumerians and Scythians coming through the Caucasus. Upon their arrival in approximately 650 BCE, they defeated a Median army to take possession of all of northern Mesopotamia. From this stronghold, which they held for 28 years, they raided as far south as Egypt, leaving horrendous damage in their wake. As Herodotus relates, the whole land was ruined because of their violence and their pride, for, besides exacting from each the tribute which was assessed, they rode about the land carrying off everyone's possessions. This time the invaders were defeated only through trickery, when their leaders were invited to a feast and, after they had drunk to excess, murdered. Soon thereafter, the great Scythian war bands dispersed and slipped back to the steppes. Not much later, in approximately 530 BCE, we find the builder of the Persian Empire, Cyrus the Great, soon after conquering Babylon, feeling threatened by a huge Scythian army, the Massagetae, that had settled into the plains north of Babylon. After apparently several years of preparation, Cyrus led his army north. At first, things went well, and Cyrus defeated a segment of the Scythian force and even captured a son of their queen, Tomyris, prompting her to write to Cyrus, "You bloodthirsty Cyrus, pride not yourself on this poor success. Now hear what I advise, and be sure I advise you for your good. Restore my son to me and get you from the land unharmed. Refuse, and I swear by the sun, bloodthirsty as you are, I will give you your fill of blood." Cyrus ignored Tomyris's warnings, and, true to her word, she destroyed the Persian army. When Cyrus's body was discovered among the slain, Tomyris ordered his head cut off and placed it in a bag filled with blood, giving him his fill. Just a generation after Cyrus's defeat and death, Herodotus details how the Persian king of kings, Darius I, around 513 BCE, tried to eliminate the Scythian threat by invading their homeland. In pursuit of his highly mobile foe, Darius pushed deep into Ukraine, and in the end, as Herodotus makes clear, the Persian army was extremely lucky to escape destruction. Although Herodotus is silent as to further conflicts between Persia and the various Scythian tribes, the Persian kings considered these nomadic tribes a continuing existential threat. How else does one explain their failure to adapt their armies to the challenge of massed Greek hoplites? In 490 BCE, outnumbered forces of heavily armored Greek hoplites decisively defeated a Persian force armed and equipped for rapid movement. That pattern was repeated, with minor variations, for over 150 years. At Plataea, during the march of Xenophon's 10,000, at Granica, Issus, and finally in the crushing defeat that Alexander inflicted upon Darius III at Gaugamela, the Persians never came up with an answer to the devastating impact of armored hoplites smashing into Persian armies protected by wicker shields. Assuming that the Persians were not fools and that they comprehended the reasons for their multiple defeats, only one thing explains a 150-year failure to adapt. The simple explanation is that, throughout this period, the Persians considered the Scythian threat to be far more dangerous than the Greek or Macedonian. Because combating the Scythians required forces that could move as fast as the steppe nomads, the Persians always placed a premium on maintaining large cavalry forces and quick-marching light infantry formations. Such a mindset made it impossible to adapt the Persian military so that it could cope with heavy hoplite infantry in a set-piece battle. The point, however, is not to judge Persian strategic choices. Rather, we need to acknowledge that even when challenged by armies that would eventually destroy their empire, the Persians remained convinced that the most serious threat they faced was the destructive power of the northern tribes. This is important because it explains many of the strategic decisions made by the Romans throughout the 500 years of the empire. If the tribes north and east of the Danube and Rhine were truly capable only of sporadic raiding with limited forces, then it is impossible to explain why, at the height of its power, Rome thought it necessary to maintain an average of 15 of its precious legions along these rivers, as well as another 3 or 4 to keep watch over restless Picts in Caledonia, Scotland. Manning these frontiers and paying for regular expeditions into barbarian lands always created a huge drain on the empire's resources, one that could be justified only if the barbarian threat was considered truly existential. But when one considers the power and might of Rome, it is hard to conceive of the empire, particularly in its early centuries, before it was riven by internal division and destructive civil wars, being threatened by motley barbarian tribes, singularly or in combination. This outlook still predominates among modern historians, who routinely state that Parthia, the only other great organized empire on Rome's borders, was always the greater strategic threat. It is strange, then, that for the first 250 years of its existence, the Roman Empire contented itself with a mere 4 to 6 legions facing the Parthians on the eastern border. Was this a strategic miscalculation on the part of Rome, or was there something to be terrified of, lurking in the mists and forests of the cold north? If it was a miscalculation, then it was one repeated by dozens of successive emperors. Worse, when Rome eventually relaxed its guard in favor of other strategic interests or other momentary priorities, it was the barbarians that swarmed in and destroyed the Western Empire and left the Eastern Empire reeling. One could argue that the barbarian groupings in the 4th and 5th centuries were of an entirely different nature than those of the early years of the empire. That is fundamentally true, but it does not negate the fact that such dangerous groupings existed even during the Principate, although they were not usually sustained over long periods. Rome had good reason to fear the northern barbarian tribes. From their earliest days, the Gauls were the greatest threat to the city's survival. In 390 BCE, a Gallic force led by the chieftain Brennus defeated a hastily assembled Roman army at the Battle of the Allia and entered the city itself. The story of the ensuing sack and Rome's revival may include more myth than reality, but these myths endured as an objective reality for the Romans well into the late empire. As such, they were always part of the mental framework upon which later strategic approaches were built. The impact on Roman attitudes was so great that the date of the Battle of the Allia, July 18th, was viewed until the end of the empire as accursed. Other parts of the 390 BCE defeat and sack also did much to set Roman attitudes and future strategic thinking. After the defeat, the Romans fortified themselves within the citadel on Capitoline Hill and prepared for a siege. Unfortunately, there was not sufficient space on the hill for the entire population, and priority was given to the young, particularly those who could bear arms. The elderly were left behind, but to ease their qualms and reconcile them to their fate, they were joined by every former Roman consul. As the Gauls moved through the cities, they saw the consuls seated around the forum in their regal gowns of office. For a long time, the Gauls were stayed from slaughter by the regal magnificence and stately manner of the consuls. Then, as Livy relates, M. Papyrus roused the passion of a Gaul, who began to stroke his beard by smiting him on the head with his ivory staff. He was the first to be killed. The others were butchered in their chairs. A general massacre of the aged Romans ensued. The Romans on the Capitoline, after withstanding a short siege, agreed to pay the Gauls 1,000 pounds of gold to depart. When the Romans complained to Brennus that the scales were calibrated to cheat them, Brennus tossed his sword on the scale, uttering words intolerable to the Roman ears, namely, "Vae victis," or "Woe to the vanquished." Before the Gauls could get away, however, they were met by another Roman army, led by the previously exiled General Camillus, which had forced marched to the city's aid. This time the Romans won a decisive victory, and according to Livy, the slaughter was total. Their camp was captured, and not even the messenger survived to report the disaster. When the annihilation was complete, Camillus supposedly stated, "Non auro sed ferro, recuperanda est patria," not by gold but by iron is the nation to be restored. Livy's and Plutarch's recountings of this tale were written hundreds of years after the event, and there are other conflicting versions. But it is their accounts that dominated the Roman imagination, and from which the Romans absorbed strategic lessons. The first of these lessons was that when dealing with barbarians, one had always to negotiate from a position of strength. The ideal, often neglected in times of crisis, was to ensure it was always the other side that suffered the woe of the vanquished. Second, and most crucial, Rome's salvation was always to be found in the iron of the legions. In the decade before Julius Caesar's lifetime, Rome's survival was again cast in doubt when fierce Germanic tribes, the Cimbri, supported by the Teutones, defeated several smaller Roman forces before annihilating a newly raised 80,000-man army at the Battle of Arazio. This was Rome's first taste of the furor Teutonicus, as described by Plutarch. Their courage and daring made them irresistible, and when they engaged in battle, they came on with the swiftness and force of fire, so that no one could withstand their onset, but all who came in their way became their prey and booty. And even many large Roman armies, with their commanders, who had been stationed to protect Transalpine Gaul, were destroyed ingloriously. This was the greatest military disaster Rome had suffered since Hannibal destroyed their field army in Cannae over 100 years earlier. But like Hannibal, who failed to follow up his great victory with an immediate march on Rome, the barbarians marched through Gaul and into Spain, rather than diverting south to finish Rome off. The delay gave the Romans time, which they put to good use. First, they elected as consul Gaius Marius, the recent victor of the Jugurthine War, and then gave him unprecedented authority to restructure the army. In what became known as the Marian Reforms, Marius did away with the requirement that a legionnaire had to own property. In a single stroke, the Roman army went from being a well-trained militia raised from the propertied classes to a professional force of long-serving soldiers, dependent upon leaders who could guarantee their pay and grants of land when they retired. Consequently, the armies of Rome, in a remarkably short time, switched their primary allegiance from the Republic to their generals. It was, of course, this switch that led inexorably to the great civil wars, first between Marius and his former subordinate Sulla, then between Caesar and Pompey, and finally between Octavian, Augustus, and Mark Antony. With this new army, Marius won a series of major victories against the barbarians, first destroying the military power of the Teutones at the Battle of Aquae Sextiae, before defeating the Cimbri at the Battle of Vercelli. In this latter, well over 100,000 Cimbri were slaughtered, the bodies left to fertilize the fields. It was later said that the people of Massalia fenced their vineyards with the bones of the fallen, and that the soil where the bodies wasted away grew so rich that it produced great harvests for many years afterward. Only 2 generations later, Marius's nephew, Julius Caesar, took nearly a half dozen years and employed as many as 8 legions to subdue the barbarian Celtic and Germanic tribes in Gaul. If Plutarch's numbers are to be believed, the conquest of Gaul involved storming 800 cities and towns, subduing 300 nations, tribes, and fighting over 3 million tribesmen in a series of pitched battles that left more than 1 million barbarians dead. If the Romans needed further proof as to the dangers presented by the barbarians, it arrived almost coincident with the advent of the empire. In 9 CE, 3 Roman legions were annihilated, presumably with all or most of their auxiliary forces, in the Teutoburgerwald, east of the Rhine. I will discuss this event at greater length later in this book, but for now, just ponder the enormousness of what it took to wreck 3 legions, close to 20,000 men, in combat. Warriors from probably 12 or more tribes had to be recruited. They all had to arrive at a specific place at a specific time, and huge amounts of food had to be available along their march routes and at the ambush site. Moreover, each group of warriors had to be trained to combat a Roman legion, and then integrated into a coherent operational plan. Finally, this supposedly hastily assembled ramshackle force had to defeat 3 veteran legions. By any measure, this was an immense organizational feat, one that, despite so much evidence to the contrary, many historians believe the barbarian tribes were incapable of, at least until the later centuries of the empire. Clearly, the barbarian tribes, milling in varying numbers along the empire's northern and southern frontiers, were a persistent danger to Rome, one that required constant vigilance. As history demonstrates, even those societies that had just barely emerged from the Neolithic period were capable of sustained military exertions that could, in the Bronze Age, bring down civilizations. They remained remarkably dangerous throughout the Iron Age, having come close to destroying the Roman Republic on more than one occasion. If the barbarian threat was not capable of destroying the Roman Empire during its first two centuries, it was still capable of inflicting horrific damage to Roman arms, as well as to substantial portions of the most exposed provinces. The threat presented by the barbarians grew as the tribes amalgamated into larger groupings in the later centuries of the empire. But from the beginning, the threat from beyond the Rhine and the Danube was always the risk the empire took most seriously, and for good reason. Chapter 3. Paying for a strategy. Funding the Republic. It took some time for Rome to discover that an empire built on the back of its legions could be made to pay for itself. After the first two wars against Carthage nearly bankrupted the state, Rome's financial woes ended upon its final victory over its only real rival in the Western Mediterranean. As the Republic's legions advanced their standard across the Eastern Mediterranean, Rome first gorged itself on the plunder of captured territories and rich cities. Then, after they had extracted all the riches readily at hand, they levied a charge on the defeated enemy for the cost of the war. As Polybius wrote, "To sweep the gold and silver, however, into their own coffers was perhaps reasonable, for it was impossible for them to aim at universal empire without crippling the means of the rest of the world and securing the same kind of resources for themselves." Only after these war indemnities, stipendia, were collected, did Rome begin the long process of knitting the conquered regions into Rome's economic network. Carthage, because of its defeat in the Second Punic War, paid into Rome's coffers over 24,000 talents, including a payment of 200 talents annually for 50 years. In another instance, after Antiochus III's armies were smashed at the Battle of Magnesia, the Seleucid ruler was forced to pay an indemnity of 15,000 talents. From what we know in the literary sources, coupled with rough estimates on the size of the take from plunder, a fair estimate is that in the 50 years after the Battle of Zama that concluded the Punic Wars, Rome received nearly 46,000 talents from its enemies, 1,050 tons of silver per year. Most of this bounty went toward fielding the army and enriching the generals. In the process, the legions became long-standing forces, more professional, and, fatally to the Republic, they began transferring their allegiance from Rome to the generals who enriched them. It is always difficult for modern listeners to grasp the enormous amount of this transfer of wealth from the other Mediterranean states to Roman coffers, which is too often expressed in talents or currencies that have no meaning in the modern world. Consequently, some perspective is needed. Pliny the Elder, in his Natural History, gives us two accountings of exactly how much money was in the Roman treasury, the aerarium Saturni, at a specific moment in time. The first, in 157 BCE, between the Second and Third Punic Wars, states that it held 17,410 pounds of gold, 22,070 pounds of silver, and 6,135,400 sesterces in minted coins. Once the calculations are done, this totals out to a little over 18 million denarii, 3,002 talents. Pliny, writing in the middle of the first century, states that, At no other period was the state more wealthy. He also notes that Aemilius Paulus, after destroying King Perseus's Macedonian army, pillaging the royal palace, plundering 70 towns, and capturing 150,000 slaves, had paid 300 million sesterces into the treasury just 14 years earlier. One gets some idea of the costs the state was incurring, mostly to fund the military, from the fact that less than 1/15 of the booty from the war with Macedon was still in the treasury just over a decade later. Still, Rome felt wealthy enough in 167 BCE to exempt all of Italy from property taxes, a privilege that lasted until the crises of the 3rd century CE. The question remains, what could Rome buy with the 18 million denarii, 3,002 talents?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.